please. 264. And as you're finding your place, let me thank Mr. Bell for leading the singing thus far. We're singing well, so let's keep that up. In loving kindness, Jesus came, my soul in mercy to reclaim. And from the depths of sin and shame, through grace he lifted me. 264, let's stand as we sing. Let's stand together. Wonderful singing. Now let's come before the Lord in a word of prayer together, please. Let's have every head bowed, every eye closed, as we still ourselves in the Master's presence. Eternal God and loving Heavenly Father, we do thank Thee and we do praise Thee for each one tonight that can sing from the depth of their soul that they are in sinking sand, yet Christ lifted me. With tender hand He lifted me. From shades of night to plains of light, all praise His name, He lifted me. No, God, we realize that our sin is serious. We realize that our sin is as that miry clay that the Psalm 40 speaks about. And yet we thank Thee for the day and hour when each one that is Thy child in this meeting experienced that loving hand of the Master lift them from the miry clay, set their feet upon a rock, and put a new song in their mouths, singing praises unto our God. And, O Father, we thank Thee for the day and hour when Thou didst save those Christians that are in this meeting tonight. But, O God, Thou knowest that we would long to see the lost in our number counted in, brought into the fold, and saved by Thy sovereign grace. We pray that Thou be pleased to move in might and power tonight, We pray that Thou be pleased to save souls. And we ask that even this gospel service may be crowned with redemption this evening. We pray in this first Sabbath day of the new year that Thou be pleased to do a wonderful work, a saving work, a redeeming work in this building, over the loudspeakers into the village of Monish Lane, online later on as people would listen to the messages as well. We believe what Isaiah 55 tells us. We believe that Thy word shall not return unto Thee void. We believe that it shall prosper in the thing whereto Thou hast sent it. We claim the promise of the word of God tonight, and we pray that Thou be pleased to even work that wonderful work of redemption in our midst this evening. But Lord, we ask that Thou be pleased to bless those in our church family that can't be out tonight. We pray that Thou be pleased to minister to them, minister to their need, even in their own homes or in the hospital ward. We pray that Thou help them and bless them. And even as many of them are thinking about the house of God, maybe reaching for their own Bible or listening to a CD or an online message, we pray that Thou be pleased to bless them, and they would know the Holy Spirit is there, presencing Himself with them. But Lord, we remember those that are laid aside and sick. Lord, we would fear for their spiritual condition too. We pray that Thou just give help. We pray that Thou minister unto their need, not only in the body, but in the soul. We pray that each one that is sick with sin would be those that know the healing touch of the Master in redemption. But, O God, we ask that Thou be pleased to bless each one in our midst tonight. We thank Thee for them. We thank Thee for the homes that they represent. And we even thank Thee for Thy common grace in the journeying mercies which Thou hast given to the house tonight. It's treacherous roads. It's cold, Lord. Thou knowest it, for Thou art the one that gave the weather. But, Lord, we thank Thee for the blessing of being in the house of God in safety. And we pray that Thou take us to our homes in safety later on as well. But bless us even in this time. And even though it may be cold outside, we pray that the preaching of the word may warm our hearts, that our hearts will burn within us as we meet with the Lord afresh tonight. We pray as we sing Thy praises, as we pray together, as we read the word, as we hear it expounded upon. We do pray that Thou minister unto our need, and we pray that Thou bless and work that work which alone is Thine to perform. And Lord, we thank Thee for each one here. We thank Thee for the older ones that have been faithful to this work for many a long year. And we thank Thee for the boys and girls too. Save them at a young age, Lord. Save them by Thy grace. Make them great warriors for King Jesus in these days. It thrills our souls to have them here. And we pray that Thou make them great warriors in the place of prayer, great knowledge in the scriptures, like the men of Issachar, knowing the signs of the times, what Israel should do. We pray that Thou raise up a godly generation in this congregation and church family. But Lord, bless us now. Help us in the worship of Thy most holy name. We plead these things in Jesus' name and His name alone. Amen. Hymn number 266, please. Hymn number 266, I will sing of my Redeemer and His wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross He suffered from the curse to set me free. We'll stand again as we sing, and let's sing it out, 266. Let's stand together.
I will sing. I will.
That's wonderful singing. Wonderful, wonderful truth. But we're turning in the Word of God together, please, to 2 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, and the chapter 24. 2 Chronicles, chapter 24. If you're using a church Bible in the pew in front of you, you'll find the portion on page 504. Page 504. But 2 Chronicles 24, reading the whole of this chapter concerning King Joash. We're going to be focusing our thoughts primarily later on the verses 19 through to 21. But we find a king that started so well and then ended so badly and so tragic, really. But we're looking at the title, When Good Men Go Rogue. When Good Men Go Rogue. 2 Chronicles 24, beginning our reading at the verse 1 together. The Word of God states, Joash was 7 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 40 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name also was Zibbah of Beersheba. We have some boys and girls in the meeting. It's hard to believe a 7-year-old king, isn't it? But nonetheless, look what we read in the verse 2. And Joash did that which was right in the sight of the Lord all the days of Jehoiada the priest. It's a wonderful line and yet a sad line at the same time, all the days of Jehoiada the priest. Verse 3, and Jehoiada took for him 2 wives, and he begat sons and daughters. And it came to pass after this that Joash was minded to repair the house of the Lord. And he gathered together the priests and the Levites and said to them, go out unto the cities of Judah and gather of all Israel money to repair the house of your God from year to year, and see that ye hasten the matter. Albeit the Levites hastened it not. And the king called for Jehoiada the chief, and said unto him, why hast thou not required of the Levites to bring in out of Judah and out of Jerusalem the collection, according to the commandment of Moses, the servant of the Lord, and of the congregation of Israel for the tabernacle of witness? For the sons of Athaliah, that wicked woman, hath broken up the house of God, and also all the dedicated things of the house of the Lord did they bestow upon Balaam. And at the king's commandment they made a chest and set it without at the gate of the house of the Lord. And they made a proclamation throughout Judah and Jerusalem to bring in to the Lord the collection that Moses, the servant of God, laid upon Israel in the wilderness. And all the princes and all the people rejoiced and brought in and cast into the chest until they had made an end. Now it came to pass that at what time the chest was brought into the king's office by the hand of the Levites, and when they saw that there was much money, the king's scribe and the high priest's officer came and emptied the chest and took it and carried it to his place again. Thus they did day by day and gathered money in abundance. And the king and Jehoiada gave it to such as did the work of the service of the house of the Lord, and hired masons and carpenters to repair the house of the Lord, and also such as wrought iron and brass to mend the house of the Lord. So the workmen wrought, and the work was perfected by them, and they set the house of God in his state and strengthened it. And when they had finished it, they brought the rest of the money before the king and Jehoiada, whereof were made vessels for the house of the Lord, even vessels to minister and to offer withal, and spoons and vessels of gold and silver. And they offered burnt offerings in the house of the Lord continually all the days of Jehoiada. But Jehoiada waxed old, was full of days when he died, and 130 years old was he when he died. And they buried him in the city of David among the kings, because he had done good in Israel, both toward God and toward his house. Now after the death of Jehoiada came the princes of Judah and made obeisance to the king, and then the king hearkened unto them. And they left the house of the Lord God of their fathers and served groves and idols, and wrath came upon Judah and Jerusalem for this their trespass. Yet he sent prophets to them to bring them again unto the Lord. And they testified against them, but they would not hear. And the Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, the priest, which stood above the people, and said unto them, Thus saith God, Why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord, that ye cannot prosper, because ye have forsaken the Lord, he hath also forsaken you. And they conspired against him, and stoned him with stones at the commandment of the king, in the court of the house of the Lord. Thus Joash the king remembered not the kindness which Jehoiada his father had done to him, but slew his son. And when he died, he said, The Lord look upon it and require it. And it came to pass at the end of the year that the host of Syria came up against him, and they came to Judah and Jerusalem and destroyed all the princes of the people from among the people, and sent all the spoil of them unto the king of Damascus. For the army of the Syrians came with a small company of men, and the Lord delivered a very great host into their hand, because they had forsaken the Lord God of their fathers. So they executed judgment against Joash. And when they were departed from him, for they left him in great diseases, his own servants conspired against him for the blood of the sons of Jehoiada the priest, and slew him on his bed, and he died. And they buried him in the city of David, but they buried him not in the sepulchres of the kings. And these are they that conspired against him, Zabad the son of Shemiath, an Ammonitess, and Jehozabad the son of Shimrith, a Moabitess. Now concerning his sons and the greatness of the burdens laid upon him and the repairing of the house of God, behold, they are written in the story of the book of the kings, and Amaziah his son reigned in his stead. We trust the Lord will bless the public reading of his holy and precious truth to each of our hearts. Now at this point in the service, let me bid each one a very warm welcome in the Saviour's name, a warm welcome once again on a very cold evening. It's good to see you here, and we trust the Lord will bless us as we gather around the scriptures of truth tonight. Monday through to Friday this week is the minister's week of prayer, so I'll be away in Armagh at that. And I trust that even this week you would remember us in prayer, that the Lord would revive us and touch our hearts, and that this week would even be a catalyst of a mighty work of God among our own denomination, and that the Lord would stir us up in the week that is before us. But therefore, on Wednesday, the prayer meeting and Bible study, the same time of 8 p.m., the Reverend Paul Hanna will be along to preach. And then the services next Lord's Day, our Sabbath school and Bible class at 10:45, and the morning worship, 12 noon, evening gospel service at 7 p.m., both of those main worship services preceded by a half hour of prayer. The Reverend Andrew Patterson will be preaching in the morning. I'll be away at Market Hill. And then the Reverend Marcus Leckie will be preaching at night. And I will be preaching in Cookstown. But today is our retiring missionary offering as you leave. Once again, let me thank you for your generosity toward the maintenance fund offering, which came to £1,050. And then just a few dates for the diary. Monash Lane's week of prayer will be not this coming week, but next week, the 15th through to the 19th of January. If you can, we trust that you will come, and you'll come not just one or two nights, but come each night. Come to the house of God and pray for the Lord's blessing upon this work. Then there's Hebron's missionary weekend in Ballymoney, Friday the 12th through to Sunday the 14th of January. Then on Friday the 19th of January at Brownlow House, 7:15, there is an interview with our brother Noel Stevenson by the Reverend David Smith, and I'm sure that's a night to be to look forward to. And then an open day of prayer for our Christian schools on the 27th of January in our Portadown congregation. And there's two seasons of prayer, 10:30 and 2 p.m., and lunch provided in between. As you leave today, the Ulster Bulwark magazine is available, so please take those with you, and please do continue to pray for those that are sick and those that are shut in, and of course those that have been bereaved of late as well. But all these announcements are subject to the will and mind of the Lord. We're going to sing again hymn number 265. We haven't ventured too far around the hymn book today, but beautiful hymns we have before us. 265, we'll keep our seats while our tithes and offerings are collected for the work in this place. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner, condemned, unclean. 265, keeping our seats. Wonderful singing. Now, turning in the Word of God once again, please, to 2 Chronicles chapter 24. 2 Chronicles 24, that portion that we read together earlier. And we're going to remind ourselves of our key verses this evening. And we're going to read from the verse 15 to the verse 22 again. Read these seven verses afresh. In a moment, we're going to be looking in greater detail at verses 19, 20. And 21. But in the verse 15 and 16, we find the reason why the good man went rogue. It's because the good men around him, or the good man around him, died. Verse 15. But Jehoiada waxed old and was full of days when he died, and 130 years old was he when he died. And they buried him in the city of David among the kings, because they had done good, because he had done good in Israel, both toward God and toward his house. And after the death of Jehoiada came the princes of Judah and made obeisance to the king. Then the king hearkened unto them, and they left the house of the Lord God of their fathers and served groves and idols. And wrath came upon Judah and Jerusalem for this their trespass. Yet he sent prophets to them to bring them again unto the Lord. But they testified against them, but they would not give ear. And the Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada the priest, which stood above the people, and said unto them, Thus saith God, Why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord, that ye cannot prosper? Because ye have forsaken the Lord, he hath also forsaken you. And they conspired against him, and stoned him with stones at the commandment of the king, in the court of the house of the Lord. Thus Joash the king remembered not the kindness which Jehoiada his father had done to him, but slew his son. And when he died, he said, The Lord look upon it and require it. Let's bow in a word of prayer. Let's ask for the Lord's help and the Lord's blessing upon the preaching of his truth tonight. Heavenly Father, we still our hearts before thee and we pray for thy help. We pray that thou be pleased to minister unto our souls. Thou knowest each one that is in, young and old. Thou knowest each one without Christ. We pray that thou be pleased to cause them to repent and believe even this evening. And we pray that thou be pleased to encourage and bless even the child of God through the preaching of the cross. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. When good men go rogue. In 2 Chronicles chapter 24, we read of King Joash. Maybe he's not that familiar to your mind, but King Joash was a good king at the start. We read that in the verse 2. He was a good king at the start, but then we essentially find a good man going rogue. And we find that often repeated phrase, but a phrase that we must take heed to. It's not how you start, but it's how you finish. It's not how you start, but it's how you finish. You know, you can start well for God and not finish well. That's a tragedy when those things happen. Look at the verse 2. We read, And Joash did that which was right in the sight of the Lord all the days of Jehoiada the priest. Now we find it was a great start. This young king, this young man, he was 7 years of age, the verse 1 says, and under the influence of a man of God, an influence of Jehoiada the high priest. And therefore the nation went well in godliness. We find that this great start included the temple being repaired and the house of God being repaired. All those things, we'll come to that in a moment. But unfortunately, after this great start, the good man died. The man of God died. Look at the verse 15. But Jehoiada waxed old, was full of days when he died, and 130 years old was he when he died. And the good man died. And you know the verse 2. It's a wonderful statement, and yet it's a sad statement all at the same time. Because it's a wonderful statement, Joash did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, but it's a sad statement because it puts a time limitation upon it. He did that which was right all the days of Jehoiada. Not all his own days, but all the days of the 130-year-old man that was his senior guide and leader. He only did that which was right as long as Jehoiada lived. Now, good was done. There's no doubt about that. The verse 4 says, It came to pass after this that Joash was minded to repair the house of the Lord. That was a wonderful thing, to repair the house of the Lord. We find in the verses 8 through to 11, we'll not read them, but he organized the tithes and the offerings again, something that just hadn't been done. In fact, it's very interesting that the Joash was the real driving force behind this. And we find that the Levites, the men of God of the time, didn't just have the same zeal that Joash had at the start. You say, how do you know that? Well, look at the end of the verse 5. It says, Howbeit the Levites hasted it not. And we find that Joash had to call Jehoiada back and say, Why haven't you got on with this? And he was a real driving force with a man of God at his shoulder advising him. We find in the verse 14, the end of it, that not only was the house of God repaired, but we find in the verse 14, the true worship was reinstated. It says, look at the end of verse 14, and they offered burnt offerings in the house of the Lord continually all the days of Jehoiada. And what a testimony this man Jehoiada had. Look at the verse 16. And they buried him in the city of David among the kings. Look at it. I've underlined it in my Bible. Because he had done good in Israel, both toward God and toward his house. You know, when you look at these little testimonials that the Holy Spirit of God gives in the Word of God, I often ask myself, if the Lord was to write one line, one verse about Daniel Henderson, what would be written? What would be written about your life? Could it be said, because he had done good in Israel, both toward God and toward his house? Is that the type of influence that we leave upon those around us? But then the good man died. He died, Jehoiada. He died a grand old age, the verse 15 tells us, and it didn't take long before the ungodly men got a hold. Verse 17, we read, after the death of Jehoiada came the princes of Judah and made obeisance to the king. Then the king hearkened unto them. And look at the advice they were giving. Verse 18, and they left the house of the Lord God of their fathers and served groves and idols. And wrath came upon Judah and Jerusalem for this their trespass. I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel we're living in similar days to that of Joash and Jehoiada. I feel sometimes we're living in days where we can look back to times when godly men influenced and ran the nation and the church in such a wonderful, remarkable, godly way. And now I believe we're coming to this time where we see those old saints passing on to glory. And the same influence isn't there. The same influence for good, the same influence in godliness isn't there. And it feels like Psalm 12 and the verse 1, help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth, for the faithful fail from among the children of men. Times it feels like the Jehoiadas are passing away, and the same type of spirit that came in Jehoiada isn't evident in the same way in 2024. I trust that will challenge each heart, young and old, here. Do we have this good, godly spirit of Jehoiada? What are we influencing the world for? Because we see this same generation coming through that is perverted and willing to persecute truth. Look what we read then in the verses 19 and 20. We'll not reread them, but we find that God sent prophets in his mercy to them. Sent a particular prophet. Look at the verse 20. The Spirit of God came upon Zechariah. Who was that man? Well, he was the son of Jehoiada. And he was filled with the Spirit of God. And he preached the word. Yet there just wasn't the interest. Look at the verse 21. And they conspired against him and stoned him with stones. Now I find it interesting. They not only conspired against him, they not only stoned him with stones, but they stoned him, they killed him, they murdered him at the commandment of the king. You think of that. The influence that Joash had, or Jehoiada had on King Joash. And now Joash is putting his son to death. Loyalty didn't stretch too far with this young man. He was killed at the commandment of the king. And look at it further. And killed, murdered in the court of the house of the Lord. He was murdered in the house of God. These are solemn truths. You know, we always need to remember that however dark the day may be, even though it feels like Jehoiada's may be passing away, God always has a remnant. God will always have a people. God will always have a preacher of the truth. God will always have a Zechariah in days of apostasy. You know that. We believe in the Word of God, or I believe anyway in the Word of God in the book of Revelation, even in the most fearful days of Antichrist, in those 3.5 years of tribulation. The Word of God talks about the Lord raising up 2 witnesses, even in the most evil of days. God will always have preachers of righteousness. The Lord never leaves himself without a witness, you know. And yet we find because of this king's sin, well, the Lord dealt with him. The Syrians came against him. They took a great host, it says in the verse 24. Then we find in the verse 25, he was He was assassinated in his bed. Look what we read, verse 25. And when they were departed from him, for they left him in great diseases, his own servants conspired against him for the blood of the sons of Jehoiada the priest, and slew him on his bed, and he died. We find the demise of this once great king. You know, it reminds me of 1 Samuel 2 in the verse 30. Them that honor me, I will honor, and they that despise me shall be lightly esteemed. Joash knew God's blessing while he lived a life and reigned God's way. As soon as he forsook the Lord forsook him, and it all came to a sad and sorry end. But what I want you to focus on in this gospel hour with the time that remains, I'm interested in what Zechariah the prophet preached. Not Jehoiada, his father, but Zechariah, in days of declension, in days of darkness, in days of evil, what did Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, preach? And look what we find in the verse 20. And the Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, the priest, which stood above the people and said unto them, Thus saith God, Why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord, that ye cannot prosper? Because ye have forsaken the Lord, he hath also forsaken you. I want you to note three things. Number one, the sin of the king. Number two, the shocking reality. And then number three, the saving grace. So number one, the sin of the king. Look what it says in the verse 20 again, halfway down. Why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord, that ye cannot prosper? Why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord? Isn't it amazing? I don't know about you, but I find it incredible the differences of attitudes to the gospel in a very short period of time. You look at Jehoiada the priest, and there was a great acceptance of the gospel in his day, and yet Jehoiada preaching the exact same thing that Zechariah, his son, preached, there's a great rejection of the gospel in his day. And it just reminds us of 2 Timothy 4 and the verse 2 again. Preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season. And ultimately, the same message can be preached in different generations, and yet one generation seeks to accept the truth and another generation seeks to reject the truth and persecute the preachers of righteousness. But there's a reason why majority of the time the gospel is rejected. There's a reason for that. There's a reason why every time we preach, generally speaking, majority of the time, it is rejected. It is scowned and people hate to hear it, and they scour at it, and they don't want it. Why? Because true gospel preaching always does what Zechariah did in his sermon. It highlights sin. It highlights God's hatred for sin. It always highlights our sin, our iniquities, our transgression, our lawlessness, our spiritual criminality against God. True gospel preaching always begins by highlighting the danger of sin. That's what Zechariah did. Read in the verse 20, that he stood above the people and said unto them, the first thing he says is, Thus saith God. So the first thing he highlights is, this is a message from Almighty God Jehovah. And the second thing he says is, why transgress ye? He deals with sin straight away. No airy-fairy nonsense, no storytelling, no gimmicks, no beating around the bush. He just gets to the question, why transgress ye the commandments? Why are you sinning? Why are you breaking God's law? And he's acting and preaching against what has happened in the verse 18. They left the house of the God of their Lord God of their fathers. They were idolatrous. Wrath came upon them. He was dealing with the sin of the nation at that particular time. We read in the verse 19 more of the type of preaching of Zechariah. The Lord sent prophets to bring them again unto the Lord. And look what it says. They testified against them. Let me say this. As preachers of the gospel, we're not only for things, but people need to know we're against things too. We're against certain things. I think it's so sad. We live in so many a day when so many pulpits are for everything. for whatever society wants, for whatever the generation would have them be for. And very few preachers are against anything. But here we find these prophets were sent, and Zechariah was sent so that he could testify against them, so he could expose their sin. Well, I want to tell you this, it's the same tonight. The Lord has sent me to ask you a question, sinner. Why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord? Why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord? Come with me to Romans chapter 3. Because you may think you're a good person. You may think you're okay. You may think because you're sitting in Monish Lane tonight that you'll be all right and your good works will be enough. Well, I'm sorry, I have to break the news to you. And ultimately, you're a sinner, you're a transgressor, you are full of iniquity. And the Word of God tells us in Romans 3 in the verse 10, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They're all gone out of the way. They're together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. Well, friend, that's you and I. That's our issue. That's our problem. Verse 23 of that same chapter highlights it afresh. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. When we look at what Zechariah had to say in this very short preaching ministry that he possessed, he highlights their sin and he says, why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord? Well, you say, well, do the commandments of the Lord still apply to my heart in Monish Lane today? Yes, they do. God's law doesn't change. The moral law of God, the Ten Commandments, does not change. Look at Exodus 20. We'll just look at some of them. And we find when we look at the moral law of God, we can ask the same question. I can ask you the same question. You can ask yourself the same question. Why transgression of the law? Why am I full of sin? Because look at the law of God. Look what the Word of God says. Now, Zechariah clearly could preach with great power and liberty on the verses 3 and 4 of Exodus 20. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Well, that's what was going on in Judah at the time. And I'm sure maybe there's some here and something in your life is ahead of God. Well, what is it? It's another god. It's another idol. Oh, friend, turn from it and turn to Christ. Look at it. It says, thou shalt not steal. You say, well, I'm not a thief. I haven't robbed a bank. But maybe you stole something little, maybe something tiny, insignificant from your employer. And you say, well, it's not that big a deal. But friend, it's stealing. Maybe you've stolen time from your employer. You were told a 10-minute break and you took 15 minutes instead. Well, what is it? It's stealing. Look at the verse 17, the 10th commandment. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. And so on and so forth. Have you ever coveted? You ever thought, I wish that was mine and it's not mine and I know it never will be mine, but I want it. You have that heart that desires these things. You know, friend, if we're honest with ourselves, and it is about honesty to ourselves, if we're honest to ourselves, we know that we have transgressed the commandments of the Lord. We know that we have sinned against God. We know that we have done wrong. And I want to emphasize this, that you and I are sinners. And you can tell me that you're a good person. You can tell the session you're a good person. You can tell everybody that you're a good person until you're blue in the face. But I know what the Word of God says, and I know you're a sinner as well as I am. I want to tell you this. God hates our sin. God hates our sin. And the psalmist tells us God is angry with the wicked every day. And that's solemn. That was the sin of the nation, the sin of the king. And that's the sin that you and I are a part of tonight, transgressing the commandments of the Lord. But then I want you to note not only the sin of the king, but secondly, the shocking reality. The shocking reality. Look what we find at the end of the verse 20. Zechariah preaches, and he says, thus saith God, why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord that ye cannot prosper? Because ye have forsaken the Lord, he hath also forsaken you. Now, friend, that is the shocking reality of our sin. Our sin is us forsaking the Lord. And we find that in our sin, it says, the Lord hath also forsaken you. What does that look like? Well, that means sin has a punishment. Sin has a punishment.
The Lord forsakes the sinner if they die in their sin, and the Lord will deal with them in wrath, not in mercy, but in wrath and justice. And what does that look like? This wrath of God and the forsaking of God to us. Romans 6 verse 23 tells us if you die in your sin, it says, for the wages of sin is death. Come with me to Revelation 21. We see greater detail. What does it mean? The wages of sin is death. Not only physical death, but spiritual death. Look at Romans 21 and the verse 8. It's speaking of hell. It's speaking of the lake of fire. It's speaking of eternal torment and wrath forevermore. It says in Revelation 21 and the verse 8, but the fearful, the unbelieving, and the abominable, and murderers, and whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. It's hell, friend. I want to tell you this, that not only is there an eternity of wrath, but also in this life, you have the abiding wrath of God upon you. You know that if you're in your sin today, you have the abiding wrath of God upon you. You say, how do you know that? Romans 1 and the verse 18 tells me, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven. That's the present tense. That's right now. Is revealed from heaven the wrath of God. Oh, friend, what a sorry and pitiful position you're in your sin. And Luke 16 tells us that hell is no party. Hell is no cushy position. We read in Luke 16 of the rich man, and it says in the verse 23, and in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments. It's a place of torment. It is quite literally torturous. Verse 24 of that same chapter says, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. Friend, you know when we come back to our verse in our chapter, 2 Chronicles chapter 24 and the verse 20, this is what it means to have the Lord forsake you. If you die in your sin, the Lord forsakes you and hell will be your portion. Hell is a reality for those that have forsaken the Lord. Because ye have forsaken the Lord, he hath also forsaken you. And friend, I urge, will you not wake up and have a rude awakening at that? Wake up to this shocking reality that is before you if you stay in your sin. As Haggai said, consider your ways. As Amos preached, prepare to meet thy God. Friend, turn from your sin. Repent, believe the gospel. I trust that you'll be in time. But then we find in our verse, 2 Chronicles 24, not only the sin of the king and the shocking reality, but number three, and last of all, the saving grace. The saving grace. Look what we find in the verse 19. I find it remarkable that in spite of what we read of them leaving the house of God, serving groves, serving idols, the wrath of God coming upon them, isn't it remarkable what the verse 19 says? Yet he sent prophets to them to bring them again unto the Lord. Isn't it incredible that even in spite of their darkness, their idolatry, their wickedness, even in spite of the fact that these are men that knew better, knew about the house of God, knew about the true worship of God, knew what ought to be done, and their wickedness was so dark and evil and iniquitous, yet the Lord in mercy sent them preachers, and sent them preachers with the aim and the ambition to bring them again unto the Lord. I don't know about you, but I see there, even in sin and nature's darkness, the saving grace of God. That God was willing to send those that would tell them the truth. It's not all bad, friend. It's not all bad. The point is this from the verse 19. You can hear the prophet Jehoiada preach. You could hear the prophet Zechariah preach. You can hear the preacher Daniel preach tonight. And you can hear the word of God. You can hear the truth that you're a transgressor and the Lord forsaking you means hell forevermore. But you can hear the truth of Christ and Calvary in the blood. And you can hear that message. You can repent and believe the gospel, and ultimately you can be brought again unto the Lord. You can be reconciled. You can have peace with God. You don't have to abide in your sin. You don't have to stay on the road to hell. You don't have to stay on the broad road. You don't have to face what your iniquity and your transgression and your sin and your spiritual criminality deserves. You don't have to face God's justice in that sense. Because of Christ, because a Savior came, because a Savior left heaven's glory and he came to this wicked world of ours and he lived a perfect life. You and I, we have transgressed God's law. We have transgressed the commandments of the Lord, but the Lord Jesus Christ, he perfectly obeyed it all. And then he died. And he died for what purpose? Romans 5 verse 6 tells us Christ died for the ungodly. The verse 8 of that same chapter says, but God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, in that while we were in transgression, in iniquity, in the mire and filth of sin, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And friend, that's what Calvary is all about. Calvary is all about the blessed Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, the God-man, God manifest in the flesh, bearing our sin upon his own body on the tree. And he died for us. He died an atoning death. He made a way so that you and I could have peace with God. He made a way through the shedding of his precious blood so that the verse 19 says, to bring them, to bring us again unto the Lord. You can be brought again to the Lord. Your sin separates you from God, but Christ died to wash away your sin. You can be brought nigh to God afresh. Oh, friend, will you not understand what Christ did? Will you not hear the message of salvation today? Will you not listen to what Zechariah the prophet preached when he said, why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord? Will you not listen to his warning? Ye have forsaken the Lord. He hath also forsaken you. Will you not see the purpose why God has his prophets in every age so that you can be brought back unto him? Oh, friend, will you not accept this wonderful message of grace and goodness and salvation that is offered to your soul? You know, I find it sad, the end of the verse 19. We find many remarkable verses in this chapter, many remarkable verses I would love to preach on. For instance, the verse 20, the Spirit of God came upon Zechariah. What a line. What a truth. We find that even the verse 21, I highlighted to you, the king commanded his death, killed in the court of the house of the Lord. What lines to preach upon? You know, the verse 19 and the last words of it, it's the most solemn of phrase. They knew the truth. They knew they were sinners. They knew the Lord's forsaking of them and the wrath that abided upon them. And yet the verse 19 says, but they would not give ear. But they would not give ear. I ask, is there one here tonight? You know of your sin. You know of hell. You know of Christ and the fact that Christ died for the ungodly. You know that all you must do is repent and believe the gospel. You know that tonight you can possess new life in Christ. I hope and pray that this line will not be written across anybody's soul as you leave, but they would not give ear. Are you deaf to the gospel tonight, friend? Are you deaf to the love of God? Are you deaf to his mercy and his grace and his goodness and his kindness? Or will you not only open your ears to his truth, but open your heart and accept him as your Lord and Savior? It's my prayer that you would hear the preacher. It's my prayer that you would acknowledge your sin.
It's my prayer that you would acknowledge you deserve to be forsaken of the Lord. Yet it's my prayer that you will be brought nigh unto him. We don't deserve it, friend. Yet the mercy of God is real. Saving grace is there. And the Lord has promised all those that come unto him. He said, I will in no wise cast out. Oh, friend, will you not trust him now? Turn from your sin and be in time before it's too late. Yet he sent prophets to them to bring them again unto the Lord. They testified against them, but they would not give ear. And the Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada the priest, which stood above the people and said unto them, Thus saith God, Why transgress ye the commandments of the Lord that ye cannot prosper? Because ye have forsaken the Lord. He hath also forsaken you. And they conspired against him and stoned him with stones at the commandment of the king in the court of the house of the Lord. They would not give ear. We trust the Lord to bless his word to each of our hearts for his own namesake. Hymn number 269, please. Hymn number 269. I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. I trust that is you, friend. I trust tonight you've heard of your sin, but now I'm coming home. The paths of sin too long I've trod. Lord, I'm coming home. Coming home. Coming home, never more to roam. By thy grace I will be thine. Lord, I'm coming home. 269, we'll stand as we sing. Let's stand together.
Thank you.
Father, we pray if there be any yet on the path of sin, hell and destruction, we pray that they would say, I'm coming home, repenting and believing the gospel even tonight. But Lord, put us in thy fear and in thy favor. Keep us in safety as it's slippy underfoot, and keep us safe on the roads. Lord, we pray that thou bless us as we're apart. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.